Welcome to Learn the Sky. In this video, I will be talking about Gemini, the famous twins who can easily be identified in the night sky. Before we begin to take a look at the shape of this constellation, it's always good to review the legend surrounding it. So Gemini is one of the few constellations that looks very similar to what it represents if you use a little bit of imagination. This constellation dates far back in time and has been referenced in many ancient texts. The twins were most often referred to as Castor and Pollux of Greek mythology. Both boys were supposedly hatched from an egg after their mother, Leda, was seduced by the Greek king of the gods, Zeus, when he was disguised as a swan. If you have heard of Helen of Troy, the beautiful woman who created a very large war, she was known as the sister to the twins. But if you look at ancient Roman mythology, the twins were thought to be Romulus and Remus, who are the founders of Rome. And if you look at this picture here, you can see that this is an ancient Roman coin, and Romulus and Remus are depicted on this coin. Here in these photos, we can see some remains of the temple of Castor and Pollux from Greek mythology. But then here we have a sculpture of Romulus and Remus, the founders of Rome, that is located in Italy. So again, we can see some lasting artifacts of this mythology is carried on even today. If we look further, in China, Castor and Pollux were the stars that were associated with yin and yang, the dual forces of nature. Gemini also appears in ancient Persian texts, and as well as Babylonian astronomy legends mention the twins as well. So again, the twins are just one of those lasting legends that pervades all different cultures and many different stories. And as always at Learn the Sky, I will always say that these stories will vary from culture to culture, and we just have to remember that as we look at the constellation, that the stories will change as time goes on. Let's take a look at the patterns of Gemini and start getting familiar with where it is situated in the night sky. So here we have a star chart, and note that this is within the northern hemisphere. I have always lived in the northern hemisphere, so I only really feel comfortable talking about the constellations from the northern hemisphere perspective, and that goes for all my videos on this channel. So Gemini is located in the winter skies, right over here. And it is also a zodiacal constellation. And if you can find Orion right here, you most certainly will be able to find Gemini, which is situated right here. Now, this is not my most favorite depiction or the shape of Gemini, because I see something very different. But you will notice, I'm hoping you'll notice, is that the ecliptic, or the path of the sun, which is represented by this dashed line, this is the path of the sun, and Gemini passes through it. Therefore, it is a zodiacal constellation. So here is our first picture of Gemini that we're going to take a look at. So take a few moments to just observe this photo and see where your eye is drawn to. Do you see the pair of bright stars that are fairly close to each other? Do you see any star clusters within here? So if you are, you're starting to notice some of the patterns, okay? So let's take a look at where Gemini is situated within this photograph. Here they are. This is Gemini, and to me, I very clearly see two stick figures, and then they're kind of laying on their side in this photograph, okay? So you have the head of the one twin, his body, two legs, and then you see that exactly on the other side. So who is who in this picture? This here is Pollux. That's the name of this star right here, and it's slightly brighter than Castor. And I always remember Castor because he has a cast on his leg. That is how I help remember what the difference is between these two constellations. So what are some of the other things that you might see in this photo? There are definitely some other bright stars and star clusters here. So here, this is where Canis Minor is, and Canis Minor is a small dog of Orion, and it only has two stars within it. So if you can find Gemini, you can definitely find Canis Minor because it's right next door to it. And then you might also notice this small cluster right here. This is a beehive cluster in Cancer, and I have another whole video on this particular constellation, which is very interesting. But again, if you can find a Gemini, you should be able to find Cancer, which is right next door. And the way I always find Cancer is by looking for this beehive cluster within it. Let's again get some more practice with Gemini. Here's Gemini again with a different perspective. So as you're looking at this, can you see two stick figures? One of the stick figures may kind of stand out to you a little bit more as well. And can you see the companion constellation that's right next to Gemini, which is Canis Minor, only two stars? Also, are you noticing the beehive cluster in here? If you're starting to notice these things, this is what will help you identify Gemini when you go outside and look for them. So here is where Gemini is. You have Pollux on the left and Castor on the right. Castor has a cast on his leg. That's just my little memory charm to help me remember. We also have Canis Minor down here, towards the bottom legs of Pollux, and then we have the beehive cluster in Cancer. All right, here's a different picture. Are you able to point out Gemini looking at this picture? First thing your eyes would probably be drawn to are the two bright stars towards the upper left-hand corner. That would be Pollux and Castor. Are you starting to remember the difference between the two? Which one's brighter, which one's a little bit more dim? Here we go. This is how I see the twins. And then here is another way to look at the constellations as well. So remember that anything within this rectangular piece is a part of Gemini. Okay? Constellations are just not the patterns within them, it's really everything within the rectangular space. And this is really meant for astronomers to make sure that they're talking about the same thing across the globe, and it helps us to keep track of the sky and what's in it. And you'll also notice the ecliptic going through it as well. Let's continue to get more practice observing Gemini. Taking a look at this beautiful photo at sunset, we want to see if we can find Gemini using Orion. So see if you can notice where Orion in this photo. If you want to draw your eyes towards the lower right-hand corner of the sunset, that's where Orion is located. And you can use the shoulders of Orion to kind of help point you out. If you draw an imaginary line from here up in this direction, you will come across Gemini right here. And if we point this out, there's where Gemini is laying on its side. And this right here, this would be a planet. I believe this is Jupiter traveling through Gemini. And the other constellations we're seeing here are Taurus, the bull, and Auriga, the charioteer, right here. So let's practice using Orion again to find Gemini. Now, when you're looking at this night sky photo, look for Orion towards the upper right-hand corner. You're not seeing the entire constellation, but a part of it. You should notice the belt stars, okay? And see if you can notice where Gemini is in relation to Orion. Okay, if Orion were standing straight up, here's Orion right here, and I'll point this out for you. If Orion were standing straight up, Gemini would always be laying on its side. We have Castor right here and Pollux, or I'm sorry, Pollux and Castor right here with the cast on his leg. Both Gemini and Orion are part of the winter hexagon, which is an asterism to help you identify where certain constellations sit. So here is Orion on a star chart, and here is Gemini. Each of their bright stars are a part of the winter hexagon. And if you use the bottom part of Orion moving up through the shoulder, this will lead you right into the area of Gemini. So use Orion to help you find the other constellations. And this is where I point this out for you as well. Orion, if you go from the bottom leg up to the shoulder, it'll lead you in the general direction of where Gemini will be. So let's practice this. Okay, here, are you able to see where Orion is? So what you want to do is, here's Orion. If you draw an imaginary line from leg to shoulder, it should point out where Gemini is as well. You can also use Orion, the belt stars right here, to point down to Sirius and Canis Major. And you can also use the belt stars to help you point out Taurus. Here's the V-shaped face of Taurus right here, and the Pleiades as well. You can use the other side of Orion to help guide you up into Auriga. Now remember, this is we have a 2D picture, but in reality, the Earth is in three dimensions. So remember, you can use Orion to help you find many other constellations. Oh, I forgot one. You can use the shoulders of Orion to help you find Canis Minor as well. So remember, it is very important to know what Orion looks like so it can help you find not only Gemini, but Taurus, Auriga, and a few of the other constellations as well. Now that you're familiar with the pattern of Gemini and how to find it, let's review some of the bright stars that are within this constellation. So first, we're going to look at Castor because this has a designation of the alpha star. And each star in a constellation has a Greek lettering system, and they usually name it based upon its brightness. So even though Castor is identified as the alpha star, it's actually the second brightest star of Gemini. It's a bluish white star, and it's really a system of six stars, even though that's too faint for you to see with the naked eye or even a pair of binoculars. It is 46 light years away, and that's one of the reasons it's so bright in the sky. Moving on, we have Pollux, and this is the brightest star of Gemini despite its beta designation. Its spectral class is that of an orange star, spectral class K, and it is 36 light years away. The third brightest star of Gemini is Alhena, and it has the gamma designation. Its spectral class is that of A, it's bluish white in color, and it's 85 light years away. Taking a look at some of the celestial objects of Gemini, here is a picture of Gemini, and notice you should be able to see the ecliptic pass through it. So the sun will pass through this constellation, making it a zodiacal constellation. And you'll notice right here is where one of those celestial objects are located. So M35 is a large, elongated open cluster, and it has about a magnitude of 5. So you can see it with the naked eye on a pretty dark night. It's about the area of the same size area of the full moon. So it's visible with the unaided eye, but of course you want to take a look at it with a pair of binoculars, and you will be able to see it a little bit more. It has about 200 stars here, and you'll actually notice there's another open cluster right nearby. Okay, so Messier 35 is right here. It's about 2800 light years away from Earth, and then you have NGC 2158. It's a little bit more compact, and it's farther away, so it's 12,000 light years away. So this smaller, more compact star cluster is one that you'll most likely need a telescope to see as opposed to a pair of binoculars. When I look at this with my binoculars, they just kind of blend in with each other. So again, just to point out where you will see this, it's by Castor's leg that has a cast. Again, that's just my own little way of remembering it. But that's where M35 is, so take a look at it and see if you can point it out. And just to remember, to give a throwback to Charles Messier, he was a French astronomer and he created these catalogs of fixed celestial objects because he was a really avid comet hunter and he was coming across these diffuse nebulous objects and thought they were comets. So, in order to distinguish the comets from the objects, he started creating a catalog and many many amateur astronomers still use his catalog of Messier objects to help find and locate these different deep sky objects. The Eskimo Nebula is also another deep sky object that is within Gemini, and this planetary nebula was discovered by William Herschel in 1787. And you can kind of see how you might be able to see ahead and then surrounded by a parka hood, so that's how it got the name Eskimo Nebula. And a planetary nebula does not have planets in it. It just has a circular shape, which some astronomers thought were planets, but it's really a star that is towards the end of its life. It's throwing off the last layers of gas that were inside the star, but no longer. So you've got a little white dwarf here, and these layers are starting to just be thrown off from the star. Okay, no fusion is really happening in here. It's just glowing from incandescent heat. And if we were to locate where the Eskimo Nebula is, you want to find Pollux, go down towards the hip area, and right here is where you would find the Eskimo Nebula. There's also a beautiful reflection nebula right near M35. Okay, it's very faint, but it's a diffuse reflection nebula located right towards the heel of Castor. The Medusa Nebula is also very interesting. It's a large planetary nebula that borders right near Canis Minor, and it's used to be a supernova remnant, or that's how it was classified, but with further study, it was found to be a planetary nebula. So you can just see, and if we take a let's take a closer look of the Medusa Nebula. It was named after the Greek mythological creature from Greek mythology, because the filaments of glowing gas really look like the serpent hair from Medusa. So again, another beautiful picture and an object for you to look for. Also, William Herschel discovered Uranus in 1781 when it was near this star in Castor's foot right here. So just another interesting tidbit. And Clyde Tombaugh also discovered Pluto when he exposed his photographic plates towards the hip of Pollux, and he was able to find Pluto. So lots of history surrounding Gemini, very, very interesting. And I've given you a lot to look for, either with your telescopes, with your binoculars, or even with the unaided eye. So to conclude our video about Gemini, the famous twins, it's best to remember that in the northern hemisphere, it's best during seen in the winter months. And it is a zodiacal constellation, which means that the sun does pass through it. The best way to find it is using Orion. You want to trace a line from Rigel to Betelgeuse up to find Gemini. The bright stars we have are Pollux and Castor, and there's lots of different cool celestial objects you can find, such as Messier number 35. Okay, the Eskimo Nebula and Medusa Nebula are in this general area, and a few other reflection nebulas as well. So be sure, if you have a pair of binoculars, take a look at it and scan through this awesome constellation. Thank you so much for watching. If you have any questions, please leave them in the comments for me to answer. And I hope to see you back soon. Thank you.
Mix it out.